The first thing we have to do is to install an operating system that allows us to easily understand how the whole system works. Windows and OS X are closed systems that make it very hard to understand on a technical level. Though, actually, OS X is very similar to Linux and a lot of concepts can be transferred, but we will use Linux because we can, for example, have a look at the Linux kernel source code to dig deeper. And also, most people come from a different OS, namely Windows or Mac, so it will be cool to learn something new. There are many distributions of Linux that all have their own flavor. For example, there is Kali Linux, formerly Backtrack, which is a Linux operating system that has a lot of pre-installed tools intended for penetration testing. There are other Linux distributions that are more aimed to be used as standard desktop environment, for example Ubuntu. A lot of people run Debian on a server to host some websites, and big companies that need operating systems with support and service contracts, they often use Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And I know many people that built their own Linux experience with Arch Linux. And there are hundreds of other distributions out there, so just Google them. When you first want to check out Linux, it's difficult to decide what to go for and you are kind of overwhelmed. And generally, I just suggest go with Ubuntu. It's a very popular distribution, it's easy to use because it's kind of aimed at people that have never used Linux before. So that's what we will do. But if you are already experienced with Linux, why not take a weekend and check out Arch Linux and build your own system from the ground up? You will fail the first time, but learn a lot. So I will install Ubuntu as a virtual machine. It makes it easier for me to record and create those videos, but it also shows another important tool that is often used for security research because you can quickly set up new systems to test something. Oftentimes, you only have one physical device, but with VMs you can just run a lot of different systems on a single machine. So first download and install the VM Workstation player. As you can see, you can download it for Linux or Windows. If you are on a Mac, you might want to try VMware Fusion, but it only has a 30-day trial. Alternatively, use VirtualBox. Then download the Ubuntu 64-bit LTS version. If you want, you can make sure that you have the same version like I do, but it doesn't really matter. This is the VMware player, and it's like a computer inside your computer. It emulates a real PC. Basically, you simply create a virtual hard drive and install anything you like on it. We will use this to install and run Linux as a so-called guest operating system, which runs inside the real operating system. Now let's create a new virtual machine. This will launch a wizard for easy installation, but we will install the OS ourselves. Then select the Linux operating system and also specify Ubuntu 64-bit. If you want to install a different Linux distribution, try to find it in the list. If it's not there, just select other Linux and select the matching kernel version. Give it a name and just use the default settings. Imagine this to be like a real physical computer. To install Linux or another operating system on it, you would have to insert the installation medium. So we will insert the Ubuntu ISO into the virtual CD drive. When we now start the VM, it will boot from the CD and guides us through the installation. There are no important settings for us here right now, so just click next, and in a later video we will probably talk about partitions, but for now just ignore it and continue. After the installation you have to restart the machine, but make sure to remove the installation medium again so it can boot from the hard drive where it was installed. Login and welcome to Linux. First thing you notice is that the window is inconveniently small, so we want to increase it. We can use the search field to find the display settings, but the menu doesn't have an option to set it to a proper 6:9 ratio. The 6:10 ratio is slightly too big and we have scroll bars. So let's go crazy and immediately check out the command line to fix this. The Arch Linux wiki is a great place to learn more about commands that you use. So it tells us that X, R, and R is a tool that allows us to configure the monitor. To open the terminal, click on the top left and type in terminal in the search bar. And those two commands just add a new option for 1920x1080. Now we also see the option in the display settings. Cool. Now let's just play a little bit with the command line to get a feeling for it, how it works, and let's compare it to the maybe more familiar graphical user interface. On the left you can see the terminal, and on the right you can see the default file explorer, which currently displays the content of the home folder. In fact, the terminal on the left side is in the exact same place. The first part shows the current user, and after the @ is the computer host name. After the colon, you will find the current location, and the tilde is an alias for your user's home folder. For example, if you execute the pwd command, it will display the current location, which is the home of the user LiveOverflow. Before we look into more commands, let me show you one of the most important sources of information for the Linux system. It is the Linux manual. So let's type man, followed by what we are interested in. In this case, pwd. You should get familiar how those pages look like, because we will use them a lot. Right here at the top it says that pwd will print the name of the current working directory. At the bottom you get the information that you can press H to display a help or Q to quit and get back to the command line. So when you press H you will see a summary of less commands. I will show you later what less is, but for now just think of it as some kind of text editor that displays file content. And this editor uses key input for navigation. So let's press Q to exit the help and Q again to exit the manual. Now we'll quickly go over some commands to navigate around the file system. If you don't know them or would like to know more about them, you should check out the man pages. Let's start with ls, which will display the files of the current folder. You can see it looks almost the same, except the graphical interface shows a shortcut to examples, while ls shows an example desktop file. That's weird. Let's use cat to look at the content of the file and investigate this issue. Cat just prints the file content in the terminal, and you can now see that it seems to be some kind of special file that defines a type link and name examples. So the terminal just displays the actual file, while the graphical user interface parses the example content file and displays it in a different way. This is one reason why many people say that Linux command line is very simple, because you don't have to know all those weird features that are different in every program. Now execute ls with the option L to display the files as a list, which also provides more information like the file permissions, ownership and date. The first character indicates if the file is a directory. Maybe you wonder why I say files while they are all directories. The reason for that is that in Linux everything is a file. Wikipedia even has an entry for everything as a file, and it reads, "This is a defining feature of Unix and its derivatives. A wide range of input-output resources, such as documents, directories, hard drives, modems, keyboards, printers, and even some inter-process and network communications, are simple streams of bytes exposed through the file system as a file." Over time, we will understand this better. Now add the option A to display all files. A and L are single character option switches, which is indicated by the hyphen prefix. Doesn't matter if you combine them or specify them separately. But suddenly you see a lot more files that start with a dot. Those dot files were hidden before. Historically, this was a bug and you can read more about it in this post, but now it's a feature and dot files are often used for config files. Now let's look at the file system. We can use cd to change the directory. Let's go to the top of the hierarchical file system, which starts at slash. Now you can also see that the tilde changed to slash, which is our new current location. If you specify a path without a slash, it's a relative path going forward from your current location. If you have a slash, it will be an absolute path. So here are just some examples. If you look at the ls output again, you notice that there are two files with dots. A single dot is referencing the current directory, so ls and ls dot is exactly the same, and double dots go one hierarchy up. So when you are in your home directory, you can use two double dots to go to the top. Okay, slow enough. Let's speed up a bit. Mkdir makes a new directory. Touch makes a new empty file. Rm deletes a file. If you want to delete a folder, you have to add the recursive option. Echo and a character sequence just prints this text. Uname and uname with different arguments provide information about your system. LL is a shortcut for ls with multiple parameters. Free shows your current memory usage, and with the parameter h, the numbers will be shown in a human readable format. Df shows file system disk space, and again, with parameter h, the numbers are in human readable format. Ps gives information about your currently running processes. With parameters, you can also show all processes with memory usage, CPU, and more. NID shows you your current user ID. One last important feature to learn about are pipes and redirection. Linux becomes very powerful once you connect multiple commands together. For example, echo prints a string, and you can redirect this output into a file by using the arrow. When you print the content of a file with cat, you can use the horizontal line, or also often called pipe, to redirect the output from cat into the input of another program. For example, you can pipe the output of the cat command into the input of the hex dump command, a tool that shows you the actual hex values behind each character. And here the hex A, for example, or decimal 10, is the new line character. You should start becoming familiar with hex, because you will use it a lot. Check out the man page of ASCII characters. You can navigate up and down with the arrow keys and exit with Q. One last thing, you can press arrow keys up in the terminal to quickly enter previous commands, and even more powerful is Ctrl R, which opens a search prompt. So if we want to do the hex dump command again, we can type it in and just hit enter once it's found. If you want to leave the prompt or generally want to quit a running program, you can hit Ctrl C. Okay, cool. And when you enter the beginning of a command, you can hit tab for tab completion. So that's it for now. Let's shut down the system with shutdown now. Oh, what is that? You must be root to shut down the machine. The root user, or also called super user, is very powerful because this user can do everything. But we are currently only the user life overflow. It's good practice to not use the root user all the time because you can do a lot of damage with it. But there is a command prefix called sudo which elevates your privileges. Execute ID with sudo, first enter your password, and then you will see that you executed it as root. So now you can use this to shut down the VM. See you next time when we will create our first program.